we have here for you today, they're successful, right? Is it LeBron James coming from the NBA? No, but I don't want you to have that as the expectation for what success is. Success is whatever you find is important. For example, if I love music and I can record me a song, that's success to me. Does that make sense? Most of y'all play video games and y'all be on YouTube and stuff like that. If I can get a stream and I've got one streamer watching me, is that success?
Yes.
So when you're listening to these speakers, make sure you're taking what they're saying and you're applying it to your life, because they're here out of the goodness of their heart to pour into you and make sure that you have somebody that's going to talk to you in a way that's going to make you successful later. So are y'all ready for our performance of Black History Month?
Yes.
Before we get started, hold on, sixth grade, hold on. I love the energy, but really. Just so you kind of know the order of how it's going to work, we're going to start off with our orchestra. They're going to play a selection for us called The African Blessing. All right. And then we've got a few of our own Geddes Middle School students that are going to do some readings, talking about some very important people, Etta James, Peebo Bryson. And they're also going to introduce our guest speakers. So again, when they're up and they're speaking, we should show respect, right? That's us not whispering, not talking. We're not slouched down. We're up listening to all of the insightful things they're going to share, right? So if you're ready, give me a thumbs up. Oh, I see a lot of thumbs up. So let's get started with our orchestra led by Miss Atkins.
Clara Smith was born in Barnburg County, South Carolina. In her youth, she worked on an African-American theater circuit and tent shows. By the late 1910s, she was appearing as a headliner at the Lyric Theater in New Orleans. And on the TOBA circuit in 1923, she settled in New York City. Appearing at cabarets and speakeasies there, that same year she made the first of her commercially successful series of gramophone recordings for Columbia Records, from whom she would continue recording through 1932. In 1933, she moved to Detroit, Michigan and worked at theaters there until her hospitalization in early 1935 for heart disease, of which she died.
Thank
introduce our distinguished speaker for today, a remarkable individual whose journey has been marked by dedication, athleticism, and commitment to education. Coming from the vibrant city of Columbia, South Carolina, our speaker ventured to the upstate area to pursue higher education at USC Upstate. During their college years, they showcased their talent as a hurdler representing the USC Upstate men's track team with distinction. Embarking on a career in education, our speaker has devoted 6 years to shaping young minds. Their initial teaching position at Chapman High School saw them imparting knowledge in the field of social studies. Not just confined to the classroom, they took the role of head cross country coach and soccer coach, exemplifying a passion for both academics and athletics. The journey continued to evolve as our speaker transitioned to his administration, assuming the role of assistant principal at Berea Middle. Today, they stand before us as assistant principal of Easy High School, bringing a wealth of experience, insight, and genuine commitment to the growth and development of every student. Please join me in welcoming a true champion of education and inspiring leader, a testament to the power of perseverance, our esteemed speaker, Mr. Cameron Pratt.
All right, this is the last group of the day. I can see if I can get the best intro of the day. So, good afternoon, everyone. How are y'all doing? Hey, that's all I need was one try. I need everyone else to get twice. First try was perfect for you guys. So I'm glad to be here. I want to thank Dr. Hall and Mr. Nelson for inviting me to speak with you guys. And I want to thank you guys, the sixth graders here at Davidson Middle School, for taking the time to listen and be such an attentive audience. I saw the energy y'all came in here with, but once it was time for the performances to start, and some of your peers to speak up here, you know, y'all really turned it on. Y'all really changed the behavior and were a great audience. So that shows me some remarkable things. And one of the best parts about me coming here is I get to lay eyes on you guys before you get to the Easy High School. Y'all get the opportunity to see my face. I get the opportunity to meet some of you guys before you transition. I know this is new to y'all still, but you just transitioned to the middle school, and then in a couple years now you'll be transitioning to the high school. But those are two important changes or jumps in your life. And I think it's very important to see people that you know. It's not a unfamiliar face once you get there. So what you can expect is this is not gonna be the last time that you guys see me for the next 3 years. You can expect to see myself, Mr. Ottendown, our principal, maybe Coach Durer or Coach Jackson, our head basketball and football coaches, to be here during lunches, in the hallways, just so you all guys can meet us and see what we are about. Because Gaddis Middle School, Easley High School are so close together that we share a lot of the same things, same mentality and goal for once you graduate high school and what we expect from you guys. And we want y'all to know that before you walk in those doors. We want students in this middle school to walk in those doors better prepared than any other middle school or transition to high school anywhere else in this area. I think that we can do that. But I'm glad to be in the middle school. Like the introduction said, last year I was assistant principal at Berea Middle School. Berea Middle School is somewhat similar to this the school here. In fact, some people that I saw the faces today went to Berea Middle School last year. You know, it was nice to see some of those familiar faces here in the crowd. So I'm glad to see you guys here. I think it's going to be fantastic. So what I'm here for today, I'm here to speak on Black history. I'm also here to share some of my own personal experiences. And you know, when Dr. Hall asked me to speak, figuring out what I was going to talk about, it was a little bit of a challenge because I knew I wanted to be here, but I'm 29 years old, so I haven't gone through things like the Civil Rights Era and stuff like that that I think you would expect to hear in a Black History Month speech. So I had to find that out. Maybe thinking about talking about some heroes, or maybe talking about some people who've done things themselves. I thought about talking about Booker T. Washington, a man born a slave, learned to read, write, and eventually taught other African Americans by starting his own school, teaching them to read, write, learn trade skills. By the time he gets doing that, I thought about talking about Harriet Tubman, a woman who was born a slave, worked to free her own people, worked for the freedom and equality of her own people. The rest of her life to do that. But I decided to spend my time talking about something a little bit different. I'm talking about Martin Luther King, Frederick Douglass, Rosa Parks, any of those people that you probably already heard of, read about, maybe have seen on a documentary. But I decided to talk about someone who you actually know, someone you can actually relate to. And so I'm going to talk about myself a little bit. And the reason I'm saying that's not for a selfish reason or anything like that, but you know, when I'm speaking about myself, I'm a black man who happens to be an educator. You know, my goal is the same as all the other educators that you see in this building, which is to have you guys become successful adults. And whatever it is that you want to be after high school, you will have the tools to do that. Y'all's career paths may be different, but you guys are going to be ready and prepared to do whatever that is. So when I say myself, I'm the people I represent. I want to be a representative of all the educators you see here and all these different classes, because they're all pouring into you for that same and that common goal, which is you guys' success. You know, that's what this whole thing is about. It's more than the math, science, history, and things like that. So when I tell my story, I'm here with you guys. I figured the best place for me to start would be middle school. In fact, a little bit before I started middle school. In elementary school, I was a star student, as I thought I was. And going into middle school, they had a magnet program called Law. And this program was set up as a school within a school, meaning that though it may have been the same school, it was two separate campuses almost. There was different wings, different teachers, different classes, and people who were in that magnet program ate at different lunches. They went on field trips like Disney World and things like that. So I wanted to be a part of that. So me and all my friends all applied to be a part of this program. There's a whole process to get into it. There's an interview, they look at your test scores, you have recommendations from teachers and things like that. And they take all that into account and determine if you are eligible to get in the program. There's only so many slots for people to get into the program. And again, me and all of my friends applied, and it's to the point in time where we have to open up our letters. So we decided the best place, our best way for us to do that is to open them all at the same time. So we called each other's house phones and got everyone on the same line so that you guys have it easy now. Snapchat group and everyone's bam in the same message. Us, it was different. You have to call, and there's a whole process to get multiple people on the same line. So we got all that done, took some time, and we all counted down and opened up our letters. We counted down from three, and I could hear the joy in everyone's voice as they got accepted. These are my real friends and real stories. Jordan, Evan, Caleb, these people all got accepted to the program. And when it's my turn to open up the letter, no, there's no rejoice for me. So I look at the letter and it says denied. So while everyone else is being accepted to the program, I didn't make it in there. And Riverhouse headed over to school within the school. So what that meant was, not only was I denied from the program, but I was also separated. All my friends were together, and I was essentially in a totally different school, missing out on all the experiences that they were going to be a part of. So the way I looked at it was simple. I said, something is wrong with the people who created this entrance standard. Now I'm gonna spend my whole sixth grade year convincing them that they're wrong. I used it as motivation. I was gonna work hard in sixth grade, get my grades up, get my test scores up, work on my interview skills, so there was no way I could be denied going into my seventh grade year when I applied again. And when I was in sixth grade, that's where I met my first black history hero, who I'm going to mention. Her name is Miss Danner. She was also the first African-American teacher who I had at that point in time in my educational career. And I told her exactly what my goals were. I told her I was not here for long. I may be in this regular general part of school for right now, but going into next year, I'm going to be in law. I'm going to get my scores up, interview skills, I'm going to be ready to go so that I will accept into that program. And she took that to heart. She made it her mission to get me prepared. So she helped me with skills, wrote me the recommendation, practiced my interview skills so that I'll be ready for the interview come summertime going to seventh grade. Now, I was humbled by my experience that first time, Y'all call the boys up, we answer the phone, and you know, we open them at the same time. But this time was a little bit different. Y'all stay with me. This time was a little bit different. I was having to open up that letter in private because, you know, I was crying and everything, sniffing, and I figured that, you know what, let's just do it by myself. Let's open the letter up on my own. And I do that, and I look at it, and I say, yeah. Someone's looking out. I look at the results, and I know I was meant to apply for this program and open the letter by myself. Because when I got denied the second time, I could cry in private. I didn't have to hear all that sniffling stuff on the phone. I didn't have to be embarrassed in front of my boys. I could just come back the next day and say, you know, I didn't get in. I didn't want to be a part of that program anyway. So what really happened was this. Going into sixth grade, I was motivated from that denial. But in seventh grade, it was different. I started to resent school, that school in particular. I started to resent education a little bit. I started to lash out, act out in class. And that earned me into a program, but it was not a magnet program. It was an all-boys program for students who were like me. Students who may have given up on education, students who may call themselves trying to be a class clown and do everything but their schoolwork and get the negative type of attention. So we're all in that same type of classroom, me and guys similar to me. And that's where I met the second Black History hero who I wanted to highlight. Her name was Ms. Rhodes. She was a strict teacher, probably the most strict teacher I had at any point in time in my educational experience. There was no time for jokes, games. I could crack a joke in that class if I wanted to, but you know, it wouldn't last too long. She didn't let that happen in her class. And as strict as she was, I felt like she was extra strict on me. I feel like everything I did, I was being nitpicked. I felt like she was targeting me. I felt like I was being singled out. I thought she flat out just did not like me. Come to realize that she was hard on me because she saw something in me. She saw that I was better than my current situation. I was better than my current behavior. And towards the end of that school year, she said, "No, Cameron, I'm tough on you because I see potential. I see something in you. I see a little bit of myself in you." That didn't mean anything to me at the time. I thought she was just saying what she said to everybody, what she may have been doing. Knowing I know as an educator now, you know, you tell all your students that because you believe in all your students, whether you believe that or not, that's the case. But it didn't mean anything to me at the time. But you know, writing this speech and thinking about it in retrospect, she truly meant that. And that was important to me. Eighth grade, I'm going to skip over that for the sake of time. But there were other heroes to me who weren't African-American who I'd be remiss if I didn't get this, give this the chance to shout them out. Miss Ortiz, Coach Brunel, and my band director, my soccer coach, things like that. These people who weren't African-Americans, they taught me skills out of the classroom, gave me an outlet, so through music, through sports, gave me leadership opportunities that I meant to have some success in the classroom, but I had other things I was successful in and showed me that there's other avenues I can do. But my goal was the same. I still wanted to. I still had the desire to do well in school and get the job or career that I wanted to. And going to high school, that's when you start thinking about all that stuff. Going to high school, I had to figure out what I wanted to do for a living. And the only thing that I knew for sure is that I wanted to help people for a living. I wanted to make a living by helping others. I thought the best way for me to do that was to become a doctor. And I failed to get in those magnet programs those three times, but I was successful going into my ninth grade year. I got into a program called Explorations. It was a math and science magnet program, which is perfect for anyone who's planning on going into the medical field. They give me all the classes I would need to be prepared for a pre-med, major, everything like that. So my life is finally on track. I'm going through those hardships, I'm going through those denials, and now everything's going the way that it should be. Fast forward through high school, maybe my junior year or my senior year, I'm at the point in time where things are still going well. I'm a standout athlete in track and field, some other sports as well. I'm in that magnet program that I worked so hard to be a part of, and things are going the way I planned it. Except for I skipped over several years, but things went different. I failed through middle school, and I'm in high school, things still aren't 100% going my way. I left out the park where I made the soccer team, and I was removed from the soccer team. I left out the part where I got into that magnet program and was released from that magnet program because my grades were not where they needed to be. I had to maintain a certain grade in those math and science classes. I didn't keep those grades up, and I was removed. My GPA was terrible. And all those things were bad things. You look at it from a high school or a school perspective, and they were. You look at them individually. But I realized that each one of those setbacks were set up for something that was positive in my life. Which is how I was dropped from the magnet program. And I realized that, you know, maybe being in the medical field isn't for me. Maybe I need to find a new direction to go, which I had to do. I realized that being cut from the soccer team was for a reason. You know, Coach Jones, he was my PE coach and track coach. He's a Hall of Famer now. He's now retired. I mean, Hall of Fame as a National Hall of Fame track coach. He's my PE coach. And when he saw me running in gym class, he realized that I was better at track than I would have been at soccer. So after trials, he goes to the soccer coach and tells him, hey, if this guy is not a varsity level athlete for you, his freshman year, cut him from the soccer team and send him to the track team. Which I couldn't stand, you know, being cut from that team after being successful in previous sports and everything like that was hard to hear. But what that did was it turned me from what would have been an average, maybe a slightly above average soccer player, to a Division I athlete when it comes to the sport of track and field. An opportunity I wouldn't have had if I wasn't removed from that team. You know, when it comes to grades, that fixed itself because if I wanted to compete on the college level, my grades had to be, you know, acceptable. They had to be at a point where a coach could see those grades and say, this is someone who's going to be on the team and stay on the team through all their time in college. And, you know, all that meant something. Everything set me up for something else. The only part is, you know, I'm close to the end of high school and I still don't know what I want to do. I know I want to help people. I want to find a way to make a living by helping people, but I need to figure out how I want to do that. So I thought that maybe I'm going to follow in the footsteps of my dad and take the finance route. So I changed. You'll see this in high school. You take classes that are geared towards what you want to do after you graduate high school. So I switched to finance, entrepreneurship, accounting, things like that. And the only reason I bring that up is clearly I'm not doing that right now. The only reason I bring it up is because that's where I met my third Black history hero by the name of Miss Wells. She was my entrepreneurship teacher, and I did well in that class. I'm a senior at this point in time, so I finally got my act together, academically, behavior, everything like that, to the point where I had free time in that class, to where I'll finish before everybody else. It's not like middle school, that I may have been a senior with a class of 9th through 12th graders in there. So I was done early, and it gave me an opportunity to have conversations, real conversations with that teacher that weren't all about academics. And I remember finishing up her class that semester and her leaving me with a quote that wasn't monumental. You wouldn't find it in a book or a poem or anything like that, but it was monumental to me. And it was, Cameron, if you can do anything in the world, no, she actually said, Cameron, I see something in you. She said, I don't know, you know, what it is that you're going to do after this, but you're going to be successful at it. You're going to be successful at whatever you're going to do, whenever you finish high school or college or whatever that is. And that stuck with me. I realized that, you know, there was someone who was in my corner that wasn't in my family, who believed that I could be successful once I walk out of these doors and I'm out of the kind of the embrace that the high school and middle school had for me. But again, I still didn't know what I was going to do. I did end up being able to run track in college. You know, Coach Jones, the coach I mentioned before, the Hall of Famer, he was able to get me on the upstate track team based on his reputation alone. He has such success, and his name carries so much weight in the state that he could pretty much call a school, and if he said this person was up to snuff, this person was ready to be an athlete at your school, the coach believed him because of the athletes and the work that he's done. That's what he did. So not only was I going to be a student at USC Upstate, but I was also going to be a student athlete on the track team. the only thing left for me to figure out is what I'm going to major in. You know, when you go to college and you have an application, you can pick undecided, but I wasn't doing that. I wanted to know exactly what I wanted to do once I finished my college career. So I went to the only person who I knew could give me an answer, and that was my mom. And I asked her, what do I do? What am I going to major in? And she told me, Cameron, if you could do anything in the world, and it didn't matter how much it paid, or if it paid at all, what would it be? And that's when I figured it out. That's when I knew all along, which is if I wanted to help people and get paid to do so, I had to be an educator. Because everybody who had helped me along the way, who had changed my life, were all educators. Sure, the doctors and other people have helped me in life and they do great work. But the people who had the biggest impact on my life and changing my life, saving my life, were all the educators. And again, I mentioned several people. Some of them are African American, some of them are not, but they're all heroes to me. Now here's the cool part. I mentioned three heroes by name. I mentioned Ms. Darren, I mentioned Ms. Rose, I mentioned Ms. Wells. They're real people. You can look them up and see what they're doing now. Ms. Darren, she was my sixth grade teacher. She is now making a living by helping people still. Ms. Darren is now an administrator, or assistant principal at Blackwood High School. And she's responsible for helping 2,000 kids every single day as assistant principal at Blackwood High School. Second person was Ms. Rose, my seventh grade teacher. She's now an assistant principal or an administrator at Richmond Northeast High School in Columbia, responsible for helping over 1,400 kids every single day, new kids enrolling every single year. Ms. Wells, entrepreneurship teacher, she's now assistant principal and administrator at Spring Valley High School, where I went to high school at, and responsible for helping over 2,000 kids every single day, growing every single year. They all made me who I am today. Cameron Pratt, assistant principal at Easley High School, responsible for helping over 1,900 kids every single day, and now the over 1,000 kids that go here on Gettys Middle School campus, because like I said before, I'm coming back. This is not a one and done thing. We are a family between Gettys Middle School and Easley High School. You can expect to see myself, Mr. Oxendine, some of our other administrators here during your lunches, and class changes, things like that, so we can continue to pour into you guys and leave y'all with something. So what does all of this have to do with Black history? And my answer is everything. Because everybody in here has an opportunity to be some form of Black history hero or a hero to somebody. Every time you are making a mark on somebody, you're creating history. Every African American or friend that you may have that you are making a positive impact on their life, you are having a part in African American history that's being made every day. So take this opportunity to have a positive impact. If you see someone going through something, reach out to that person. Find a way to help them. You don't have to get paid to do so, but you never know if you're changing that person's life. If you're the strong friend who never complains or anything like that, but you're going through something, realize that what you're going through is probably setting you up for something positive later on in life. Nothing that's negative right now may be good, but at least it'll give you the skill to grow and learn and grow from that later on. So don't be too hard on yourself. But everybody here has the opportunity to be like all the educators you see here every single day. They choose to be here. They choose to mold your spot in history. They choose to mold your spot here in African American history. So if you think they're being hard on you, or tough on you, or they're singling you out, odds are they see something in you. Odds are they're trying to push you to be something better, not picking on you. They want you to be better than what you can see right now, because they've been there. They've made the mistakes. They've made the mistakes, so you don't have to. They know where it goes. Listen to them. But you can be that person as well. So when you leave out of here, find some way to help somebody. Be the change that you want to see in the people around you. I want to thank y'all for being such a great audience. I will see you guys soon. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
James, born January 28, 1938, Atkins, South Carolina, died January 20, 2012, was a popular American rhythm and blues entertainer who, in time, became a successful ballad singer. She was known for her hit songs. Ella Jane released numerous hit songs throughout her career, including At Last, I'd Rather Go Blind, and Tell Mama. Her powerful vocals and emotional delivery resonated with an audience worldwide. She was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1993. Ella Jane was honored with induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. This recognition solidified her status as a music legend and celebrated her contribution to the industry. She had a successful acting career. Ella Jane showcased her talent beyond music and pursued an acting career. She appeared in films such as Cadillac Records and 20 Bucks, further displaying her versatility as an entertainer. She received the Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award. In 2003, Ella Jane was honored with the Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award for her contribution, yes, to the music industry. Pastor Buford is not only a social leader but a spiritual communicator, making a significant impact in our community. He serves as a founder at the pastor of One Church, located right here in East South Carolina. One Church under Pastor Buford's guidance stands as a testament to a loving, vibrant, and life-giving ministry. It transcends boundaries, reaching people of all generations, socioeconomic status, and ethnic backgrounds. The ministry core principle led to a Pastor Buford is to bring everyone into oneness with God in a powerful mission to change lives, to change the world. Pastor Buford is a dynamic leader, and his passion for the word in this community is evident in his charisma. Clear and comprehensible preaching style. He has been unlikely positioned to provide leadership and development in his refreshing ministry concept at One Church. On a personal note, Pastor Buford is blessed with a beautiful family. He is happy marrying with Sharetta M. Buford, and together they are proud parents with two incredible children, a daughter named Bailey and a son named Britton. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to a spiritual guide, communicator, influencer, and devoted family man, Pastor Artis J. Buford, as he shares his wisdom and experiences with us today.
Thank you, Alyssa. Good afternoon, Getty's sixth graders. How y'all doing? Awesome, awesome, awesome. Thank you, Dr. Hall. Thank you, Principal Nelson, to the administration for allowing us to be here. As she did say, my name is Artis J. Buford. I am glad to be with you on this afternoon to be able to share a couple of things that we're going to talk about. Make sure my clip is going to reach. Here we go. Let me get on this side. Let me tell you a little bit about myself so that you can know who I am real quick, because she read some stuff. Y'all wasn't listening, so I'm gonna give you a visual aid to help guide. I'm from a small town called Kershaw, South Carolina. I left Kershaw. The green dot is where we are. Kershaw is the red dot. I'm gonna try to do this quicker than a rapid fire pizza, so 180 seconds, so somebody put me on the clock. I went to a high school called Andrew Jackson High School. I left high school and then traveled and went to Newberry College. They are now the Wolves. Back then when I went, they were not the Wolves, they were the Indians. NCAA had to change the mascot, so they're not Native American, and so then they adopted the Wolves mascot. Later on after college, I met this young lady named Sharetta Buford. Well, she was Sharetta Wynn back then. We got married, had a couple of kids. One of them is sitting in this audience right now. I'm not going to embarrass her. We also have another one. He's at East End. We have four fish and a poodle dog. Bryce is 67.5 pounds. He's a big standard poodle, all right? We had eight fish at one time, but now we're down to four. We might get another four at some point in time. Around 2013, we relocated from the metro area to come all the way up here to Easley, South Carolina, which is right back where we are at the Green Dot. Since we've been here in Easley, ministry brought us to this area. God led us to start one church. I not only lead locally here at one church, but I also am a state leader in our national fellowship, which is called the Full Gospel Baptist Church Fellowship. This July, I will be consecrated as a bishop and want to oversee all the state, all the churches here in South Carolina. And then I'm a part of a whole lot of other stuff. I'm a business owner, Cap Alpha Psi, NAACP, United Christian Ministries, as well as the immediate past chair of the Greater Easley Chamber of Commerce. Was I on the clock? Did anybody? I'm quicker than a rapid fire pizza. Awesome, 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 awesome. So now that you know who I am, I need to know who you are. So, here we go. Here we go, Miss Jack, happy birthday edition. I need to know who are the best at GMS, all right? We're gonna do it by season. So this is what it is. When I call out the season that your birthday is in, you have about 5 seconds to make some noise. And I'm gonna see who's the liveliest season birthday crew. Who has the winners at GMS? Y'all gotta be quiet, y'all gotta be quiet. I'm on the clock. Here we go, y'all ready? All right. Next up on the clock is the month, is the season of spring. So if your birthday All right. Here we go. So listen, I got the gauge. So I'm gonna count you down. I'm gonna say your month, and I'm gonna count you down, and when I cut you off, you gotta stop. Because if you got real ribs, you can know when to start and when to stop. You know? Yeah. All right, here we go. Summer. I can tell who's not in music. I can tell who's not in band of chorus. Y'all don't know the cutoff. Here we go. All right, where are my fall birthdays? February, but my birthday is in January. My daughter's is in December. So we saving the best for last. So let me hear the winter. All right. So here it is. This is what we're going to talk about today. My topic to you. Stay with me, you will definitely get a chance to talk. We got some interaction that we're gonna have. So for this to work, stay with me and follow through. So my topic today is talking about Black History is our history. My shirt says Black History is American History. You're here on Black History Month, and so we're gonna go on a little journey. Y'all ready to go on a journey with me?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is what I need you to know. Let's get ready to go. Strings, I'm so sorry y'all can't see this. I'm so sorry. You know, and I was a music theory major, so I understand y'all getting left out. That's all right, Jordan, we got you. Here we go. So, as I said, this is going to be interactive, right? This is going to be interactive. I'm going to give you an opportunity to talk back with me. So let me lay the ground rules. Here are the ground rules for our interaction. I'll say a couple phrases. One of the phrases I'm going to say is, you know what? And when I say you know what, your response will be what?
Chicken butt.
Exactly. So we're going to try it. I'm going to say, you know what?
What?
Let's try it again. You know what?
What?
All right. You got it. Here it is. Another phrase I'm going to say is, but wait. And you will say, there's more. So when I say, but wait.
There's more.
But wait.
There's more.
All right. There we go. Another phrase that I have, another thing that I want you to understand, is I'll tell you how many claps. So if I say give me two claps, let me hear. All right? Not only do we like to do clapping, but we're gonna do snaps. So if I say give me three snaps, let me hear. Now let's put it together, give me two claps, three snaps. All right, and then finally, it's gonna reach. We're gonna work it out. There we go. Final phrase is when I say, are you ready? You will say, ready. Are you ready? All right, here we go. Here we go. Are you ready? Are you ready? When we think about Black History, oftentimes we want to start our Black History moments as being something that is just selective to one group of society. But during our journey today, if y'all ride with me, you will be able to understand that Black History is American history. It's the history of where our nation is, where our nation has come from, and all that is a part of it. Black history is not just American history, but it's also world history. It's the contribution of those who helped shape the culture of the world and everything that goes a part of it. Not only is Black history American history and world history, Black history is also my history as an individual. But in addition to it being my history as an individual, it is your history as individuals in this audience, regardless of how much melanin you have in your skin, regardless of how dark your skin might be. Therefore, if it is my history, if it's your history, if it's world history, if it's American history, we want to talk about today that Black history is our history. And as we talk about Black history is our history, it's something that we all should be able to celebrate. So give me two claps. There you go, y'all still rolling with me. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go, making sure y'all hadn't fallen off the bus. So, many times Black history will start about our past. It'll go all the way back and we'll just hear stuff about slavery. But Black history precedes slavery on the shores of these United States of America. It actually goes to a global history. It goes to a global history. And so, when we hear names of our past and where we were, it's a good thing to understand that, but that's not all that Black history is about. But wait. I forgot. But wait. That's right, that's right. It's not about just what happened in the past, but Black history also is what is going on right now in the present. And in the present, we have certain individuals that are up there where we are. Black history is about where we were. Black history is about where we are. When we look at those who are currently making history during my generation, I'm old enough to be everybody's dad in here, not at one time, but I'm old enough. But the generation of the educators, of the parents, that's where we are. But wait,
there's more.
It's also about where we are going. And that's why it's our history. That's why it's our history. And for you to understand that you are a part of Black history in and of itself, that you have to understand things like the people upon your generation who are doing major stuff. There are some individuals doing some major stuff who are your age, who are making notable contribution in various areas. You can't see all the pictures up there, but the oldest person in the picture is about 16 years old. You have individuals like Marley Diaz, who is leading efforts in tackling underrepresentation in youth literature. And she started the movement called 1000 Black Girl Books campaign when she was just 10 years old. There's Quill Lemons, who's the youngest photographer to ever shoot the cover of a Vanity Fair magazine. There's Amanda Garvin. I'm sorry, Amanda is the oldest one up there. She's 22. She's the notable National Youth Poet Laureate, who was able to speak at the inauguration, the last presidential inauguration. You have Grace Moore, who's the youngest composer for the New York Philharmonic. All of this It's stuff that is happening right now, and the list goes on and on and on to individuals who are making history. There is Mr. Nichols Jackson, whose picture up there, who at 13 years old, he made history in 2020 as a junior world bull riding champion. Anybody got any farmers in the house? Any farmers? Two snaps for the farmers. Two snaps for the farmers. Two snaps for the farmers. There we go. Awesome, awesome. Okay. Then we got Quentin Byfield, who became the youngest drafted black hockey player in NHL history as the second overall pick by the Los Angeles Kings. Anybody like hockey? Okay, one clap for hockey. There we go. Somebody said they didn't like it. Here we go. All right. Then we have Najah Aquil, who fought the national rule to allow student athletes of different ethnicities and different backgrounds and cultures to be able to wear their hijabs in athletics. And so the list goes on and on and on. There's Shantae Davis at 17, who was urging lawmakers about climate change. And Janai Patton at 14, who developed an app for kids to be able to keep in touch with their parents, whether they're on distances or incarcerated or on different medical leaves. And so there's so many black history makers that are happening and that are making things happen in the different realms of the world, whether it be sports, whether it be science, whether it be the arts, or whether it be politics. And that's something that's awesome. Give them three claps. All right, all right. But you know what? That was the first one. You forgot about that. But you know what? The story continues. There we go. There it is. The story continues. Because it's not just where we were, where we are, where we're going, it's what your contribution to this world is going to be. And so the story continues, history story continues with those of you that are seated in this room even right now. The contributions that you're gonna make to technology, the contributions that you're going to make to the sciences, the contribution that you're gonna make in the medical field, the contributions that you're gonna make to this economy, to this world system, it is still yet to be determined. So you have an opportunity to be an ally, to be an advocate, to be a support, to be one to help move history farther and forward into the future. Give yourselves five claps. And two snaps. All right. So now, I think my time is almost up because I'm on the clock. It's group participation time. You always got to get participation points. So this is what I'm gonna do. As I talked about, black history is our history. Our daily lives are always impacted in the things that we do every day about the history of African Americans and people of color in this country and in this world. And that's important for us to understand. And so this is what we're gonna do. When I call out an item that you use or that impacts your life in a positive or negative way, I want you to stand up without saying a word. Just stand up. And by the end of the story, we'll see who's standing and who's sitting. And then I'll be out of here. And then y'all can get ready to go home or wherever you gotta go. All right? Are you ready?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right. We're gonna calm it down with two claps. Here it is. And two snaps. All right. How does black history impact our lives? It impacts our lives every day. It impacts our lives in the things that we do. It impacts our lives in every aspect. And in that, it's important for us to understand it's not just one person's history, but black history is our history. So when you wake up in the morning and it's dark, and you either flip the light switch or you tell the special, well, at our house we call the special lady because whenever you say her name, she always asks. You tell Alexa or whoever to turn on the light, and the light comes on. You need to be appreciative for the carbon filament made in the light bulb that was contributed by a black inventor named Mr. Lewis Latimer in 1881. Remember the instructions. If it impacts your life, if you use it, you can stand up. So yeah, you can stand up. So if you've ever had to turn on the light, you can stand up. Or quietly, settle down with two snaps and one clap. Did I get everybody on the light?
No.
Okay.
No, you didn't. This
well, here you go. Here's the next thing. When you brush teeth, and I hope you do it every day, twice a day, right? Give me one clap. Give me two snaps. Are you ready?
Ready.
Are you ready?
Ready?
All right, here's the next one. When you brush your teeth, you need to think about Miss Lydia O. Newman for the synthetic brushes that allows us to be able to groom ourselves. When you iron your clothes, because your rears are so good, you don't want to come to school wrinkly. You need to think about Sarah Boone, who invented the ironing board. When you comb your hair, think about Walter Sammons, who helped with the comb. You need to think about George Salmon when you have to dry your clothes because after you've used them in the washing machine. When you tie up your shoes, Jane E. Metzinger with the lacing machine. When it's cold in the house, think about Alice Parker with the central heating furnace. When you want a snack and you go grab some Lay's or some Pringles or whatever your brand of chips are, think about George Crumb, who is integral in the potato chip. When you get old enough to drive, how many of y'all ready to drive? Give me two claps if you're ready to drive. Give me two snaps if you're gonna be a good driver. But wait. I have to listen, here it is. When you get ready to drive, think about Richard Spikes, who helped with the automatic gear shift, so you can drive the automatic and not have to worry about a clutch and a gear shift. When you want to go fast and you're blessed to be able to have a supercharged engine, Mr. Joseph Gamble is the one to thank. When you get to make sure you don't go speeding too fast downtown and you get at a stoplight, Mr. Garrett Morgan is the one you need to think about. And when you need to do something you're not supposed to be doing, or you something you are supposed to be doing, and you pull out your cell phone, think about Henry T. Sampson, who's the engineer that pioneered the groundwork for cellular technology. When you go to the restaurant, give me one snap, two clap, one snap, two claps for good food. There it is. When you go to the restaurant to eat good food, it arrived on a refrigerated truck that was a part of the invention of Mr. Frederick McKinley Jones in 1940. When you get old enough to make money and have bills, are you ready? Are you ready? If you're ready to have some money and make bills, remember, with money comes bills, and you got to go to the mailbox. It was invented by Philip Downing in 1891. And when you go home to keep yourself safe, think about Marie Van Britten Brown, who invented the home security system that laid the groundwork for modern security systems. Remember how our lives were affected by Black history. But wait. And this is what I leave you with, so give me one clap, two snap, one clap, two snap, last time, one clap, two snaps. For my final statement, and this is this, as you go home today, as you enjoy the rest of your life, as you excel at everything you do, please remember, Black history is American history, Black history is world history, Black history is my history. It's your history, it's our history. Take your seats and give yourselves a hand. Thank you, that is my time. I appreciate you. Y'all have a good day. grade, and you can hear Dr. Hall clap one time. Clap two times. Clap one time. Clap two times. We've got one more special performance for you. Wait, I'm still here talking. Let me get one time. Two times. I still hear voices. One time. Two times. Sixth grade, I still hear voices. This is the last time for Dr. Hall. I've got one more chance for you to get settled down. If you can hear me, clap one time. Clap two times. Clap three times. I know it's been a long day. We've got one more special performance for you. We've got our boys that they want to present a song, and then we're going to get ready to have a wonderful rest of our day, all right? So stay seated. Make sure you are respectful as they are speaking or singing. And we're about to end our Black History Month program, all right? Sixth grade, how are we doing today?
Good!
Y'all listen here. I want y'all to focus. In the back, y'all listen. This song I'm going to sing to you is an important song. It's called I Know Where I've Been. Please be respectful to your peers. Don't be making noise while they're singing. You good on that? Okay.
To
Thank you.